Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo, and we're getting into the big issue of the day. We want to look at AGOA arrangement. Recently, the United States struck off Uganda from the list of those countries that are benefiting. Uganda comes after countries like Sudan, Niger, Central African Republic, and others over what they call violations of human rights. But what we want to look at this morning is that what next and what impact does this have for the country? My guests this morning are John Britell, American Chamber of Commerce board member, and also Honorable Fred Opolot, Pingre County Member of Parliament in the 11th Parliament. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Thank you. Good morning.
Thank you for having us.
Let me start with you, John. What exactly does AGOA mean for purposes of Ugandans to understand?
Well, I'm glad we just talked about this. I think it's important to get some just basic policy straight, you know, and we were talking about it in the context of aid. AGOA is purely a tariff relief program. And so for companies who meet that standard, who have products that kind of fit under the AGOA list, there's a number, thousands of products that fit under this list, you get qualified to get a tariff relief, meaning a tax relief on the entry of your product into the States. Mm. And I think there was probably at the beginning a little bit of a misconception about you know, what AGOA meant for Ugandans and or even African countries. And a lot of people, I think, thought that maybe it was in part a little bit of an aid program where maybe training or other services were going to be offered to you know, the private sector here. But it's purely a tariff relief program. So if you don't already have a company that's at scale, that is making a number of products that can actually fit into the market of the United States, then it's not going to work for you. There are a number of small-time producers that work and benefit under it, but it's fairly minimal.
What does this mean actually for Uganda, such arrangements of tariff-free, you know, arrangements and of course programs for the country like Uganda, Honorable Fred?
I think the concept, the policy is fantastic. Because the U.S., I think that was a cornerstone of the U.S. Uganda trade relations. So I think that is it is very, very good. But then, you know, we don't want to underplay, because I've heard a lot of comments about in regards to this. We cannot underplay the impact of AGOA, first of all. Specifically on companies that were successfully accessed the U.S. market. Mm-hmm. There are those companies, obviously, and I'm pretty sure that the removal of AGOA from Uganda by itself has affected these companies. Of course, they've affected their income streams, they've affected the people they have employed. I'm sure that because of this, the many people are now, especially young people, are being unemployed. But having said that, it is important to note that the AGOA's contribution to Uganda's economy was actually quite minimal, because in totality, I believe that the U.S., the trade between the U.S. and Uganda, or rather exports of Ugandan products to the U.S. amount to about 70 million USD.
The total trade?
The total.
170 something?
The USD, that's 170 billion.
$170 million, I think.
$170 million? Well, juxtapose that with the export through AGOA, which amounted to about 10 million US dollars. So that's really, really such a small
component of it.
Exactly. But
All right. I wanted actually to bring out the issue of US struck off Uganda, citing human rights violations. John, what impact does this going to put onto Uganda's trade balance with the US going forward?
Well, I just think initially it's... well, we're saying $10 million, right? So that's kind of the number there. But I think it also has ripple effects. You know, as a member of the chamber, we represent private sector interests, right? We're totally separate and independent mm-hmm. from the State Department and from the U.S. government, but we do communicate and work closely with them. So we do know that you know, there are a number of gross human rights violations, according to them. I think our role here at the private sector is to figure out how do we deal with that and how do we work with that and how do we adjust knowing that these policies are taking place. We're already seeing a number of programs, you know, long-standing institutional ones that have been here for quite a long time, Johns Hopkins, Baylor, these kinds of programs, pulling and withdrawing their programs in Uganda, and these are millions of dollars. I know that, though, on the flip side, trade is still happening. So of the 170 or so million of trade that happens between us, the Uganda market, and the U.S., it's still mm-hmm. taking place. Obviously, it's going to impact the tariff relief on that $10 million worth of company, which is does have some impact, but it's fairly minimal. Mm. So there is going to be an impact, and I think obviously there's a wider impact. World Bank has mentioned mm-hmm. some things. I think you have an IMF repercussion. You have all these ancillary institutions which are saying, okay, do we now participate in Uganda in terms of a market? And that's for the donor-oriented programs. Mm-hmm. I think on the private sector, you are hearing the there's an open for business letter that was out there. It was addressed to the president that ends up indicating that, you know, diversity and inclusion are things that are important to the business community. And there tend to be very natural, you know, GDP points in economic positive economic benefit when you have that inclusion into the market. So that's the position that they're taking. So is there going to be impact? I think absolutely. I think mm-hmm. we contribute from the U.S. government side close to $1.5 billion every year to the Ugandan economy. That's in either the health, defense, security, or CDC and other programs. And this is separate from the private sector. So there's probably going to be some impact. I don't know exactly what. We don't represent that interest. What I do know on the private sector side from the American firms that we're representing in the chamber is we have a very specific Know Your Policy campaign. So in terms of our value to our private sector members, we actually communicate what's happening with this policy, how is it going to impact you, and is it something that you need to be worried about?
Absolutely. Before I go back to Honorable Fred, I want actually to ask you, do you think U.S. took the right decision, or it was an abuse of AGOA from the American point of view?
Well, I don't represent the U.S. government, and obviously, I don't think personally I'm here to speak on that. On behalf of the chamber, I think for us at private sector firms, we have to respond to it. So whether it's right or wrong, we have to play with the rules that are out there.
That are involved.
That's our position.
Absolutely. Honorable Fred, the State Minister for Industry, Honorable David Bahat, actually responded saying that they are not going to bow to U.S.'s pressure, saying that their culture and values have to be maintained. Was that a correct response from Uganda?
Correct or not, I think what I want us to concentrate or is the impact or not of AGOA. But what I certainly know is that the government's resolve on ensuring that our economy is diversified. And in fact, when you talk about the companies that probably have had or AGOA decision has directly affected, I don't think it's a disaster, because these are companies, first of all, who I believe that have met international standards in as far as their products are concerned. Therefore, I believe that it is an opportunity for them to actually aggressively look for new markets. The countries out there who are pretty willing to embrace products for Uganda, as long as they meet the standards, they have high quality. I don't believe we as a country really should worry so much. It is an opportunity for us as a country to diversify, to look at other economic blocks. As he has already said, there's already trade, vibrant trade between Uganda and the U.S. Minus AGOA, and I'm pretty sure that that's still going on. There's a European market. There are the trade blocks within Africa. There's the EAC here. In fact, the EAC is our largest trading partner. There's the COMESA market. So, I mean, I don't think for us as a country, we ought to worry as much.
John, why do you think, because you are, I think you agree that the impact is going to be a little minimal, why do you think it has actually been so complicated for companies to actually be able to enjoy the benefits of AGOA, to even reach that standard? Because looks like it's been around for quite some time, but it has been not, because for the many years it has been here, and then at the end of the day, somebody's saying it's minimal. What needs to be changed?
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I think if you add up, I think it started in 2000 or 2001. Mm-hmm. So we're what, year 22 or year 23 right now. I think if you add it up every year's AGOA benefit, I think you're talking maybe 1 year's worth of trade, maybe, right? You know, I was talking to the Honorable Fred earlier, and it almost feels like maybe this is also another opportunity, right? If you look at, I was telling him the cap for an SME in the States is approximately $250 million US dollars. A $250 million US dollar company in Uganda is a large company. The largest company in Uganda is approximately $400 million US dollars. So that's a big company. Mm-hmm. So our market is a different size than the market that you're looking at in terms of a buyer market. Mm-hmm. So the just the scale comparison is just not there. And so, you know, there are companies that actually are already exporting, so why can't they expand and do more? And or why can't they get other investment to actually look at this from that perspective? And could a policy actually be there to support that? It's really interesting to see what's happening in Kenya with the free trade agreement. Obviously, they've got a new ambassador there. But they're doing a lot of good work in terms of promoting U.S. and Kenya trade. I think that would be really interesting. Is there a possibility to do that with trade representatives from the Ugandan government and the U.S. government to go ahead and push that forward? I think that would be the direction you'd want to take it, as opposed to focusing purely on a policy that clearly hasn't quite contributed as much as we'd want it to. Use that to say, okay, well, how do we create something that would actually work for Ugandan companies in the U.S. market? So there's a mismatch, and I think we need to align that. So I think it's an opportunity in my view, and there's, you know, I think one of the first ones is, I don't know if it'll happen, but you have direct flights, right, from Nairobi to, I think, Atlanta and maybe a few other cities. I mean, if there was a direct flight, that would just help just getting from point A to point B, right? I mean, just something very basic like that.
And indeed, new routes are being opened.
Right.
I know that the Nigeria route is being opened. London route, we're reclaiming that direct route to London.
Right.
So, I mean, that by it can be a fantastic conduit to helping business.
Why do you think it has actually been a tug of war, for example, to even get into AGOA? Because the bans seem to, everybody seem to be ignoring it, saying
that's correct.
This is not. Are there some encumbrances that have been in AGOA that actually have been stopping Uganda from exploiting the opportunity?
As you just said, I mean, accessing the U.S. market is not that easy, because there are a lot of requirements in as far as conformity
to AGOA,
to standards is concerned. And that by itself, and especially given and I believe that AGOA really targeted the SMEs of Uganda. And the SMEs, I don't think, majority of them did not live to those sort of requirements. But also, I think another problem is internal, I dare say. A lot of people, heard about AGOA when this issue came up. They're scrambling. What is AGOA? They've just got to know what AGOA is.
We didn't do much.
I do not believe Uganda promoted AGOA, that opportunity, as much as it should do.
So, meaning that there was that gap. They should have actually promoted it even more.
They should have. They should have aggressively, because, I mean, there were about, I think, 1,800 products that were sort of open to export to the U.S. market. So I think, in my opinion, that was huge. You would have seized that opportunity with enthusiasm of which we didn't. So it's unfortunate that whilst AGOA was still there for us to take advantage of, we just couldn't do it.
So in other words, it becomes a little useless to fight for
exactly.
it.
Exactly. So you're talking about, I mean, come on, 30 billion. Mm. That's really...
But I think to add to what Fred's saying is if you think about those products and saying, okay, if we were going to improve on AGOA, okay, those products are the ones that are going to the U.S. market, which are getting this tariff relief. How do you take advantage of those? Mm. Is there a fund or a capital program that allows companies to take on investment so that they can actually improve and get that way? Is there a training program that's associated with that market? Is there a matchmaking program with a particular buyer in that market to go and promote that trade to make it happen? I think that's actually a much bigger gap than a very basic gap, like who's there buying my we were talking about the bag lady, who's buying my bags in the United States and who's willing to take, you know, a half a container and not 10.
Absolutely.
And so I think just something based, these are very basic things that a program could very easily, if you had a program that actually did that, that would be different than just, then you could take advantage of an AGOA.
Absolutely. Right? You actually raised a very important issue about the free trade agreement that Kenya is now signing. Are you suggesting Uganda should enter negotiation in that area, and what difference would it actually cause, for example?
I'm just seeing the idea. I'm just saying, look, if it's working in one area, why can't we make the application in another if it's just our neighbor? I'm not sure what the State Department or the U.S. government is thinking in terms of an FTA. Also, there has to be that interest, right, between the two.
Yeah.
I think what's interesting between the Kenyan and the U.S. conversation, I think there has been a buildup when they got their new ambassador. It was sort of this big, how do we create this African trade thing, and how do we do it around consensus in an economy where you have some scale? If you think about it in terms of the American corporates, you don't see American corporates headquartering in Kampala. You'll see them headquartering in Joburg. Or in Nairobi, and then they'll send over staff here, or they'll create an ancillary office here. So you just—that's just the multinational sort of model, right? That's the way they work. If the market's not big enough, they're not going to put a presence there. Has to be enough market for them to go forward. And I think that, you know, as the market matures, you're going to see more of that shift. And I think it is happening. It's sort of happening at that level. We see it at the chamber. You do see more companies. We're constantly getting companies entering the Ugandan market. We see that on an annual basis. Our membership continues to grow. We have our core members, our President's Club and Vice President Club members, but we're constantly seeing new members entering the market. And these are what we see if you really think about it from a sector perspective. You see a lot of technology-oriented companies coming in. And so I think if we're really smart about that, you sort of take advantage of those future, the future direction of where we're going. I know right now we're focused on agriculture, which, you know, provides how much in terms of our GDP, right? Very minimal. As much as it is our largest export, there's other sectors where the future is going, and how do we take advantage of that? And I think what you see in Kenya and these other markets is they're saying, hey, that's the future. That's the future, and how do we take advantage of that?
Absolutely. Honorable Fred, do you think there should be another arrangement other than AGOA? For example, what Kenya is doing is still part of AGOA, but at the same time engaging an FTA. Don't you find that this is even going to be a start of another ban of exports beyond just AGOA?
I really hope not, but also hope that our people who are responsible, directly responsible to economic interaction with countries like the U.S. Should be really creative and aggressive, because our neighbors in Kenya are absolutely aggressive in as far as finding markets for their products is concerned, and promoting international trade is concerned. So really, for us as a country, we just simply have to be serious. I know that the president has tasked, especially our missions abroad, to focus on economic diplomacy, and I think and is a flagship policy. I know for sure, as the Minister of Foreign Affairs. I think that if we are serious as Ugandans and people who work for Ugandans, I don't think there's a cause to worry.
Yeah. Now, we've been talking about AGOA and what it is and the impact that the implication that is likely to cause. Let's talk about the post-AGOA situations and environment for Uganda. Where should Uganda focus so much? And because you've been talking about finding markets elsewhere and of course forgetting about US, where should be the focus this time round? And this is where I want actually to start on after taking this very short break. Okay. We are discussing the implications of AGOA, and of course we want to take a short break. When we return, we want to continue with what should be the center of focus for Ugandan exporters now that AGOA is no more. Have a very good morning. Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabe. We are discussing the implications of AGOA, and my guests this morning are Honorable Fred Opolot, Member of Parliament for Pingire County in Selere District, and also Mr. John Brittle, American Chamber of Commerce Board Member. Thank you so much for joining me once again. Let's go on the issue of post-AGOA. We have known AGOA is no more. Where did we go wrong? Honorable Fred, let me start with you. What needs to be done and where should be our focus this time around?
I think it's not the first time such, I could really call it a sanction, has happened. In recent times, the same happened in Rwanda. And Rwanda literally sees that opportunity to strengthen its industrial base, especially where textiles are concerned. And to a point that I think maybe 60% Rwanda is self-sustaining in the textile industry, as far as I know. So again, this avails an opportunity for us as a country, number one, to diversify our products, to ensure that our industrial base is vibrant. We saw through COVID how because of that challenge, Uganda, the president, was at the forefront of ensuring that we produce the basic products, for instance, the sanitizers and so forth. And guess what happened? Yes, we saved a lot of money, especially US dollars in imports. And in fact, we started earning in US dollar through exports, especially in sanitizers within the our regional markets. So I think we cannot undervalue, underrate the significance or the impact of industrial development in our country. Secondly, again, I've mentioned about exploring the new markets, and especially our embassies abroad are really focused on that. Wherever they identify potential partners to Uganda vis-a-vis the products that we can export to those countries. And again, you know, we need not necessarily, yes, it is good, but I think let us start with addressing the proximity, the ESC market. It is our largest trading bloc, the COMESA. The West African country right now, there is that African Free Trade Area that is being operationalized. So there's a huge potential. So I think for us, we just need to be creative. Our governments have to support the business community, especially the SMEs. I know that it has been very active in supporting the FDIs, the foreign direct investors, through maybe availing them of free land and other tax breaks. It should also try and do the reverse for the SMEs in Uganda. So support them, ensure that the investment climate for the SMEs in Uganda is fantastic. So that's really what you need to do going forward.
John, where should be the focus from the trade side of it? I mean, you've seen it undergo, and you know what the Americans want. Where should Uganda focus on, and which products you think that actually should be the focus for Ugandans to even explore other markets as well?
I don't know. I don't know if I'm the right person to answer the question. I mean, I'm not an advisor to that whole trade conversation. I just, if I'm looking at it from a business perspective and thinking about it from the private sector and saying, you know, how do you leverage what it is that Uganda has that can kind of go into the States? I think the NDP-3 does that, right, fairly well. It's tourism is huge, right? So how do you draw that relationship back to Uganda in terms of tourism, right? So that's where this impacts, right? I mean, the number of people who didn't come to a number of the recent events were in the thousands, right? I mean, so all that tourism flow is totally decreased.
Yes.
I think that as much as agriculture is a mainstay and you have to do it politically, I just don't see how agriculture is the way forward for the country. As much as it is an export earner, it just feels like services seems to be the direction most are headed. I know there's a huge industrial push. I get that. You have to lower the cost of energy. That you'd also have to lower the cost of capital for that to make it kind of fly. So industrialization becomes that sort of middle ground there. And I think there's a number of different areas. Fashion is a big area. Media is a big area. Food and beverage on the manufacturing side is a big area. Obviously, we understand that around alcohol, food and beverage. And I just think that with the whole wave of what's happening with new tech, and there are some things that both NITA, Ministry of Science and Technology, and a few other agencies, Uganda Communications Commission, are doing to support that technology element. So it feels like, you know, that direction is the way that where the U.S. is focused. And you're seeing that on our side, and probably in terms of a market, what you need to think about. So how do we retool to do that, right? How do we, are we just retooling people just to figure out how to make furniture? Or are we retooling to, you know, how to write code and how to do advanced mathematics and do these other things? There's no reason why we can't do that. There's no reason.
Ordinarily, actually, we've been pushing so much agriculture. Because of course it was the biggest.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Honorable Fred, is there any issue? Is there any way we can actually diversify and maybe look at other areas like what John is talking about? And how do we do that?
I think the case here, again, it actually strikes me that Uganda, by the way, is rated as one of the countries of the world with a good entrepreneurship. There's people in Uganda actually are very creative where entrepreneurship are concerned. Yes. But we may talk about exports of agriculture and new tech and all these initiatives. But ultimately, what is the cost of capital? It doesn't matter what you do, what is the cost of capital in this country? And I think that is a huge encumbrance. And therefore, again, it goes back to government, what it can do to ensure that it engages the financial institutions and see how it actually can help bring the cost of borrowing, especially for SMEs, to ensure that they actively participate in whatever we do.
The new markets you've been talking about, I'm sure there are countries like there are India, there is now China, Japan. Do you find this a better destination, and what needs to be actually done? Do we have also to look at other standards away from what actually been looking at from the one of the US?
Almost the same standards. These are international high value markets. So you know the issue of standards will still come to play. You're talking about the EU market. I know.
Which equally has conditions. Anytime you actually can be told to.
Yeah, I know traders.
traders, <stop.
laughs> traders who've exported to the EU market, the UK, and have had their products bounced back and with huge losses. So, yes, whereas we have to access those markets, there's still the issue of standards, but also not forgetting that for us to effectively, because we're talking about how effectively can impact on Uganda's economy. The volumes. The volumes.
The quantities.
Yeah, the quantities. Because if someone orders, again, we were just sharing that a global brand like TK Maxx ordered 10,000 units of furniture from a certain entity, SME in Uganda, 10,000, and they couldn't meet that sort of demand. They could only produce 1,000 or so. So I think, and why couldn't they meet that demand? Possibly, and I'm very sure, is the, you know, their capacity to produce. And why didn't they have that capacity to produce? The cost of capital. It's as simple as that. And unless we address that issue, I think we'll still struggle.
Looks like to meet some. Looks like actually these countries, because there is an issue that happened, I think, between US and Venezuela, where when OPEC actually took a different decision, they had to go to countries they had earlier sanctioned, like Venezuela, with Maduro's administration, they never supported.
Correct.
Should Uganda find ways of how it can as well invest in things that, for example, countries that are thinking of sanctioning it in the future can't do away with? And what could be those areas, I mean? I don't know whether, John, you have views on that.
This is non-chamber views. This is very this is now personal views for me. I just think as a country, you're going to have to do what you need to do to protect your industry, protect your trade, and ultimately you're trying to improve the livelihoods of your people. So what's the best way to do that? Now, if you're being sanctioned by other states, then you need to find a way to go about that. Obviously, there's a huge conversation around import substitution. Because you import so much, how do you start creating those industries here that end up supporting that defense sort of against that importation? And it's been known that countries where there are sanctions end up finding those avenues to go ahead and do that. I think I was just listening to an economist podcast around the movement of money, and when you talk about that in Hamas, for instance, with the Israeli war, they found ways to go ahead and move capital right outside of the system, which allows them to still function and do their thing, and they can do it no matter how many sanctions you throw on them. They still know how to move their capital.
Absolutely.
And so that idea, you want to apply that in a positive context and say, hey, what are the things that Uganda can do? Not in the context to do it for, you know, against the retaliation, but in the defense just to be a thriving economy, right? I don't think you can never get rid of international trade, because there's always going to be a comparative advantage where somebody else does something better than you, lower cost of manufacturing. You're never going to be able to compete on that market. Let's find the things where you're good at. Tourism.
You talked about
technology. Tourism. You're talking about if you really.
My mind was going for coffee.
coffee. It's a high-value product.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So absolutely.
Cocoa, coffee, pineapples. Some of your minerals here are some of the highest value. I think your. Okay, I know your pineapples are the best in the world, because I've tried them all, and yours are the best in the world. Your cocoa is extremely good. Your coffee is some of the best, single origin. Right, when you think about it from a regional, the four regions of Arabica, and even your Robusta is fantastic. The birthplace of it is here. So you're right. You want to take advantage of those things, right? And drive those things. And I think that's where you'd want to put the investment. But if you look at the way the coffee market is structured, I don't know if you necessarily want to go with the most recent plans that they had suggested. I think that's not really the smart way to do it. But if you look at the way it's structured, you do want to think about how do you get greater investment for firms locally to do more, but you don't want to completely cut out the foreign market, because there's still a part.
We even recently actually had a discussion about. We even had a company that was contracted to teach people how to drink coffee.
No, but
I mean, our, you know, no. Have we?
I think
are there other arrangements other than actually exports? Because somebody was asking me that.
Local demand.
Would you, for example, focus so much on satisfying and also ensuring that your market consumes your products before you even move out? Is that a good suggestion, Fred?
It is a fantastic suggestion. I don't know about teaching people how to drink coffee necessarily, but I think the idea was, again, to ensure that we grow the domestic market. We cannot necessarily just rely on exports. Ignoring the potential of the local market, so I think it's important, local and regional. Regional, why? Because of accessibility.
Yes.
To export your goods, products to South Sudan
and extremely
cheap. Exactly.
Yeah. So actually, we've been talking about China, India, and Japan. I know from not from a political point of view, but of course from the trade point of view. Are there no effects, for example, because we have dealt with US, US seems to be putting in conditions, and of course, certainly being close allies with the European Union, you will find some, you know, sanctions coming in from that side. Are there no trade impacts, for example, effects that would come with Uganda if it, for example, choose to go elsewhere, China, Japan, from a trade perspective? I want to start with John on that.
Meaning that would impact, of course there's going to be an impact, but you're saying in the context that instead of trading the 175 million with the states on those products, you move it to say a China or an India or a Japan. I think the impact for us would be, I mean, to do that you'd have to find a new buyer. You're talking about a new shipping route. You're talking about new trust relationship. You're talking about whether or not, well, I think there's some DTAs in there, but I think it's possible, and I just think the impact for the country, I think the idea would be is you'd want to transition just to a new market. Now, whether or not there's a dip to get there is unknown, because you can't just say, oh, today I've shipped my container, and tomorrow I'm shipping my container.
Absolutely.
You know, to the other one. So there's going to be some kind of a gap there. Now, the question would be, if that's the transition plan for the government, how are they then gap-filling that? And are they, or do they have the resources to do that? I think this is the bigger challenge. So it's not as easy as to say, okay, we're going to switch. There has to be some kind of a support mechanism to allow them to do that. Otherwise, you're probably going to see some kind of a,
Oh, all right. Honorable Fred, what are your thoughts about that?
I mean, given the current situation with the U.S. and specifically in the context of AGOA, do we have any option? I don't think so. We certainly must start vibrantly exploring these new markets. Certainly there will be challenges, you know, this new shipping line is not very, it's not easy. And that's where governments, our government has to kick in. So it is important that we explore those new markets to reduce on the shocks of sanctions such as AGOA.
Yeah, and but you could be actually running away from just sanctions from AGOA when there are actually other, you know,
it's
effects.
Possible.
I mean, negative effects from the other side.
I don't see any.
And I'm very, very certain Joe Biden never
Ugandan,
signed on something that
I will tell you,
doesn't have certain
I'll
clear
tell you,
impact.
As a Ugandan, I wouldn't really focus or concentrate on the negative effects. Let me just do the job of ensuring that our products get sold outside Uganda. Just focus on it.
Are you referring to like the. So, okay, so in the U.S. context, you might have conditions, but maybe in a Eastern. Context that might be
more
throwing away, securing certain assets against that trade.
Absolutely.
As an example, the airport conversation, which obviously the airport is still Ugandan, but that idea that that debt sort of, or that support sort of captures local assets. Yeah, I mean, that's the challenge, right?
Absolutely. And that's why actually I was even asking Honorable Fred that we could be looking just at the sanction. Could be trying to run away from that, and yet actually we are running into another deep ditch and deep end.
And then at the end
of the day, you may find yourself like,
I don't think
do
so
I return?
Well,
do
it,
I
may,
exit
it may happen, but who tells you that Uganda's economy can, especially exports, can purely depend on the US, Europe, and these other external markets? No.
But all of that has happened to countries. Zimbabwe has been actually getting into a very tough situation that direction. Are we just being blinded by just politics and
it
just
may
because
be,
of disagreements
it may be
between the government or the administration?
If you're giving an example of Zimbabwe, it may be, because I don't have the facts, it may be that Zimbabwe actually did not explore the regional market, the African markets. It concentrated on these other high-value markets like the U.S. And when you do that, when you really focus all your attention and efforts in that, at one point, there's going to be a problem, as we are currently witnessing with AGOA. And thank God, the impact of AGOA's removal from Uganda, it's going to be extremely minimal. And I want to believe that should Uganda divert its attention, say, to Europe or China and these other markets, and the United States brings all this power to sort of, it will be embarrassing. really. Mm. It will be embarrassing for such a power to suppress a country like Uganda, to in ensuring that it actually, you know, tries as much as possible to grow its economy. I may happen, it may not, but let's concentrate, let's be creative, let's go to Nigeria, let's go to South Africa, let's go elsewhere in Africa. There, you know, people buy our products, and Uganda, as he's already said, we've got fantastic products, we've got good, fantastic pineapple, we've got the coffee, you go to the Arab world, they're in all of our coffee. You go to Algeria, Algeria has made billions of liters of once our milk, in billions of liters. Yeah? So it's just that we cannot meet that demand, unfortunately. Yeah? But the, you know, I don't, I personally wouldn't worry. I'm, anyway, maybe I'm just an optimist. Maybe I'm just an optimist by nature.
Now that you are speaking like a real chair of the Nanalindo movement,
I'll come back to you.
John, we have to wind up this. Would you really give suggestions to traders, producers, and of course, exporters on what they need to do to ensure that this politics, international politics, doesn't in any way affect them?
Well, I think one of the things I know for our members of the chamber is they should be looking to us for some form of a KYC, not a KYC, but kind of a know your, not a know your customer, but a know your policy. And so they obviously should be doing that to understand what the impacts are against their labor and their interests, because a lot of the companies are represented by group. It's not fully autonomous here at the local level. So we believe that's like first. So let's get the right information out there first. When it comes to the SMEs and sort of leveraging the ongoing trade, I think it's sort of the same. I think it's a similar conversation we started earlier is how do you find access to good sources of capital that can support you, and how can we draw in those better trade relationships with the buyers and these other partners to kind of support that, and how do we get the government to kind of support that conversation, because a lot of it has to do with security and collateral on this side, is how do you get that relationship going so that there's some kind of an ease of doing business. If there's any hostility of doing business, business doesn't do well in war. You need peace for business to kind of thrive, right? Certain types of businesses do well in war, but so that you can't have that hostility. You want that enabling environment here for businesses to do well. Low cost of energy, low cost of capital. And then and the availability of that capital, go ahead and do those things. That I think should be where the focus is on the Ugandan government side. I think on the US side, there is no, it's just saying a go is not there, but it's not saying there's no trade. Trade is going to continue to take place. I know that the State Department has already indicated that they're willing and open to working with all the businesses. They've made that very clear. We issued statements about that from the chamber side. They're very much in support of that in that context of trade. But for the SMEs, I still think, you know, that's why I'm saying this is potentially an opportunity for another type of program or policy that might work in favor of the scale of what's happening here in Uganda in terms of the businesses. That should be the conversation.
All right. Honorable Fred, from the government point of view, you're a member of parliament, and from the policy point of view, share your advice and, of course, suggestions to the people post-AGOA situation.
Of course, when you talk about post-AGOA situation, you majorly referring to our exports. And I think we, again, it is important that first and foremost, for those that had been participating in the AGOA's arrangement, to very quickly engage or explore other markets. We have our missions abroad. We have about 36 embassies all over the world. I think that could be the starting point in ensuring that they get uptake of their products. Secondly, they should engage certain government departments, that's, for instance, the Export Promotions Board. I know that they can get good directions from there and advice on what other markets to explore, and that is in view of the realization that their products are actually of international standards. That's where we start from. Secondly, there are those that aspire to export and have been doing it. Mm-hmm. You know, they just have to. But government has to do something about the capital, the affordability of capital.
Of access to capital.
It's important.
Absolutely.
Because the aspirations and also the ability to actually do it. Mm-hmm. And those are the two different things. So government has to do something.
All right. Thank you. Honorable Fred Opolot, Member of Parliament, John Brittle from American Chamber of Commerce. Thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Thank you very much.
It's been The Big Issue. We are taking a short break. Rush Talk returns with Mais Ramity. Good morning. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now.